All right, good evening. It's 6 o'clock. It's time to start. We continue where we finished last time. And let me remind you, where was this? So we consider several examples illustrating different ways to construct Bayesian estimators and tests. So the last example, there were several in estimation context where we have illustrated both cases of quadratic loss and absolute value loss and how we construct the estimator. And also the last example was about Bayesian hypothesis testing where we had this prior on the theta parameter and we tested H0 of theta less or equal than 0.2 against H1 bigger than theta bigger than 0.2 for different hypothetical examples. I also gave you one last problem exercise, which I don't intend to discuss here because it is already third or fourth example in a row with a similar content. And also in this file that I gave you, its solution is presented. So you can just try to reproduce it, or if you cannot reproduce it, you can just follow there the derivations that I have given you. There is one more important aspect of Bayesian inference. However, I decided to skip this part. I have it will be not examinable for two reasons. First of all, we don't have enough time to cover Bayesian inference, and we have already a special course that is devoted to Bayesian inference, MATS 5960. And if you want to go deeper into inference, then you are welcome to enroll in this course. So this treats some cases which I have avoided here, namely when I was discussing the explicit form of the Bayesian estimators, for example, I was assuming that those integrals that pop up there are possible to be calculated analytically. And in these cases that we have considered, which are, so to say, textbook examples, this was the case. In more general situation, this will not be the case, and then you have to do something to approximate these integrals, which can be, say, done via Monte Carlo simulations, or alternatively, there is a specific algorithm in more general settings, which is called the Gibbs sampling, where you assume that you have two conditionals of y given x and x given y, where you can simulate for those. And based on this, you can evaluate the Gibbs sampling chain, which is very useful in the context of Bayesian estimation. There is also theory about what to do when these conditionals are known only up to some proportionality constant, in which case you can replace this Gibbs sampling chain by the so-called Metropolis-Hastings algorithm. And in fact, I have summarized this, what actually the Metropolis-Hastings algorithm is. So if somebody is interested, they can try to read through this. And if they have questions, they can also ask me. However, this part will not be examinable. And so I will not ask you to actually do this, only in case that you are interested in, you can read through. So in this way, I have finished my lecture two, and I will continue now with the next lecture. Lecture three. So until now, as I said and announced in advance, in lecture two, we were considering one of the ways out of the unpleasant situation that there are no uniformly best rules for each state theta of the nature. And that was when you look at the risk and you don't evaluate it particularly and each point theta and want to minimize it at each particular point theta, but you somehow weigh the different values and aggregate them into one quantity that you want to then minimize. And so this led us to a Bayesian approach, and also where these weights come from the prior, and also the minimax approach, which is a particular Bayesian approach where you're just looking at what happens at the worst possible state of nature and try to perform best in this situation. However, there are also other ways, namely when you try to reduce the number of competitors for the price of best, namely you put some regularity conditions and you explicitly cancel out, do not allow in the competition, some of the decisions which are not regular enough in a sense. Such a requirement, for example, was the unbiasedness requirement. And then you'll see that when we put this as a requirement, we will be able to find optimal decision rules in the class of, say, unbiased. And this is what will be discussed actually in this lecture and also in next week. So I start here with this lecture three, which is first about when we, so we will not be dealing with priors and with Bayes anymore. We are now in frequentist context. We just believe data telling us the story. And when we have the data, how do we do inference? Which are the principles that we are meant to obey in order to perform nice inference. So in that setting, we will speak about how we can actually reduce the data in the whole sample into some sort of condensed information about what we are looking for example, about to estimate the parameter. And here we will touch the notion of sufficiency. So this is the sufficient reduction of the data in the form of sufficient statistic, and why this is good and what is the sufficiency principle. Then we will speak how we can find sufficient statistics in practice by examining the Neyman-Fisher factorization criteria, and then we'll apply all those in several examples. Also, we will speak about the minimal sufficient statistic, which is condense the biggest reduction of the data without losing information about the parameter, which is also very strongly related to some specific exponential family of distributions very often used in inference that help you to deliver such minimal sufficient statistics relatively simply. So we will speak about the sufficiency principle, but we will also shortly mention some other principles of inference, such as the ancillarity principle and also the weak likelihood principle. And then we will discuss the notions of information and likelihood on which basis of which we will then discuss the so-called Kramer-Rao information bound for the quality of the unbiased estimator. So this is roughly the content of this section three. And we start now with the data reduction. Again, if you have any questions, you can put them in the chat and we can continue that way. So now, data reduction is something that you always do in statistics. Imagine that you have a certain parameter to estimate. This parameter, and to start with, is usually just with a small dimension of 1 or 2 or 3, for example, in the Poisson, you have the lambda one-dimensional. In the normal case, you have, say, mu and sigma squared, 2 parameters to estimate. Any say, basic case, say, densities are parametric, usually with a finite number of parameters, and you want to estimate them. So if you want to estimate them, and you have, say, a big, large sample, say, of 100 or 200 observations, what do you do? You somehow transform them, okay? Use some transformation to create, say, of this 100 observation, one value which will be used to estimate, say, the mu, and another value which will be used to estimate, say, the sigma square if we are speaking about a normal distribution. Okay, so we are doing this data reduction all the time. Okay, so suppose that we have vector of n id observations from certain density, which is parameterized by the parameter theta. We want to do inference about this theta based on these observations. The entropy of observations takes values in certain script X sample space, which we have already spoken about, and statistician wants to use them to make inference about the theta. And what we do, what he does exactly, you transform this into certain statistic. So the statistic is a random variable because it involves those n random variables that you have in your sample. But its dimension is much less than the sample size. That's why we say that we are doing data reduction. Okay. So, for example, with the n in the normal distribution on the back of our mind, the dimension of the statistic will be just 2. No matter whether you had, say, 100 or 1 million observations. Okay. So this statistic is meant to summarize the data in that rather than the reporting the whole entropy of observations, it only reports the value of the resulting statistic. So for example, Tx could be just the arithmetic mean of the n observations here. Okay, so just one dimensional parameter. Okay, so you can imagine that when you do this transformation, you are doing data reduction. And so basically, when you do data reduction, you somehow potentially could lose information about your population because you have, say, all this information in the 100 observation, you reduce it, say, in just 1 or 2 values via the transformations that you use. And if this hasn't been done in a clever way, then the information that you get in this, say, 1 or 2 values of your, say, scalar or vector statistic may be less than the information in the whole sample. So when we speak about data reduction, we immediately ask this data reduction to be performed in an efficient way so that no information about the unknown parameter is lost by this process. Okay? So how can we symbolically represent such data reduction? We can represent it as a partitioning of the sample space into disjoint subsets. What is meant by this is the following. If you have your sample and you calculate certain transformation, for example, the arithmetic mean, then what will happen is that, say, for some values of your x in the sample, you get, say, one value of the arithmetic mean. For others, you get other value of the arithmetic mean. So at the end of the day, what will happen is that, say, symbolically, or maybe graphically, if you have, say, the whole sample, say, script X, you say, look at all those values of the single points X that are your intervals of observation, potential realizations, which give rise to the same value of the statistic. So maybe all those here give rise to one specific value, T1 of the statistic. Then some others here give the same value, T2 of the statistic, and so on. T3 here, maybe. These are the values of the statistic that is obtained when you calculate your statistic on the corresponding interval of observations. Let me just have a question. Look at the questions. Is T here also the index set of a filtration? No, there is no filtration here involved. We don't speak about filtration here. So as I said, T is just notation of a transformation of your sample. Okay. So it's just a function. For example, you have x1, x2, x100, and T is 1 over 100 times the sum of these xi's from 1 to 100, the average. Okay. And so what I'm saying is that, you can do always such decomposition of the sample space into such sets, you can say E1 and A2 and A3, which give rise to the same value of the statistic. And then when you unite them, of course, you will get the whole sample space. So if you consider, say, those values that are a result of certain application of your statistic on a certain data pot point and tuple, unite all those T values, then the corresponding sets A in the sample space script text that have given rise to the same value T, united over the possible values of T, will just reproduce your sample space. So the sample space is partitioned that way in this AT subsample. So this is, say, for example, AT1, AT2, and so on. And they are united and give you the sample space. So remember now, I will speak about this sufficiency. And this is related to this partition that I described on the previous slide to be a sufficient partition. So I want to explain what this means. And to this, I will recall again what is the goal in data reduction. The goal is that when using the value of the statistic, we want to not lose information about the theta parameter. We said if we are condensing too much the information and in our statistic, and we have potentially potentially it can happen that we lose information, and we don't want this. Okay, so the data reduction has to be performed, if possible, in such way that we don't lose information about it. This is our goal. Okay, so in particular, if the statistic T has preserved all the information about the theta, that means that all these values of the interpels that have given rise to the same value of the statistic, they will be equally good for our inference. So that means if you have, say, any two samples, both X and both Y, which are such that when I calculate the value of the statistic on them, it is the same, okay? then if we claim that we have not lost information by using this particular statistic, then they will be treated, and the inference about the theta should be the same. They will be treated as equivalent with respect to the inference about theta. And so the inference about the theta should be the same no matter whether the x tuple or the y tuple has been observed, as long as the value of the statistic on the x and on the y tuple is the same. And so this is what we mean under sufficiency. We want to discuss this sufficiency in terms of the partitions that I mentioned. So I said that when I calculate the statistic, I'm actually creating a partition of the sample space. This whole script X is subdivided into those AT, where AT are all those, contains all those X's for which the value of the statistic is equal to the small t. And then script A is just the union of all those AT's. And now I want to say that the way we have done this partition that I sketched on the previous slide is sufficient when I consider the conditional probability of my potential sample vector to be equal to small x, given that small x is in certain partition AT, this conditional probability does not depend on theta. This is exactly mathematically saying what I already was saying with words and intuitively. If you think about what is said here, it says, remember that small x is particular realization of an n tuple of observations. So here is my whole sample, okay? And here is what happens when I calculate the statistic on this sample. Okay, and I say that conditionally on what I have observed as a value of my statistic, namely this small t, no matter which x has been in AT, the probability for a particular sample, a whole sample, this conditional value of the statistic does not depend on theta. With other words, when I have observed the value of the statistic already, knowing the whole sample's realization is irrelevant for gaining additional information about the parameter theta. The whole information is already contained in the value of the statistic. This is why this is called also sufficient. Again, there is a question. Let me see here. What are the questions? what are AT, sir, could you repeat that? Okay. So somebody replied to this. AT is, yeah, the set of all these X's in the sample space, which are such that when I calculate the value of the statistic, I get the same value of the of the statistic. And another question, should x in AT be lowercase x? No, it is large because there may be several n tuples which give the same value, small t. Okay? Imagine you are evaluating the mean based on 100 observations. If you repeat your experiment, you may get different, set of 100 observations. But if it happens that for those both sets of 100 observations, their average gives rise to the same value, then they belong to the same partition. All right? But X itself is random because there may be several realizations, as I said, which give rise to the same value of the statistic. So it's not only one, there could be many. Okay, again, somebody else asked. Do we have a formal definition of a statistic? Is it any function from the sample to R? Yes, for our purposes, for the purposes of this course, statistic is just transformation, okay? We don't speak here about some, we avoid some measurability issues which are not that important for our statistical course. If you study, say, measure theory and probability, then you may try to give a more rigorous definition, but for our purpose, this is enough. It is just a transformation, but it's not necessarily R. It can be R2, it can be R3, R4, depending on the dimension of the parameter that you are interested in. Hope this is this clarifies these things. Okay. So when we have this sufficient partition, then if the statistic T is such that it generates sufficient partition on the sample space, then this statistic itself is called sufficient. Okay, so we look at the partitions, and if these partitions are sufficient partitions, then the statistic that has generated them is called sufficient statistic. Of course, the partitions, they are defined via the statistic, as you can see here, because AT is defined as all those axes in the sample space which are such that the value of the statistic is the same. So you need to calculate the statistic. All right. And if this sounds a little bit abstract to anyone, then I will give you here a simple example. So this is the example of the Bernoulli case, which we have already treated earlier in our lectures. So we have now N IID observations from Bernoulli. Bernoulli was success, failure, sham with the probability of success equal to theta and the failure 1 minus theta, and the theta is the parameter of interest, and it also has the meaning of the expected value of this distribution. And that means if we have, say, a particular observation from this Bernoulli, then it is the probability for it to be equal to certain small xi. Particularization is given by this formula, where xi cannot be anything else than 0 and 1, okay? Because these are just the values of the Bernoulli. It's either success, which is coded as 1, or failure, which is coded as 0. And you can really see here that if you put, say, x equal to 0, you will get 1 minus theta, which is the probability for failure. Whereas if you put x equal to 1, you will get theta, which is the probability for success. Okay? And now we have n such axes. And now we are looking at the partition of the sample space, which is created by such potential realizations of N IID Bernoullis, okay? And I claim that those A's are actually A0, A1, and AN, whereby AN, say AR, I denote all those interpels of X for which their sum is equal to R. So please pay attention. These are many, perhaps, because if you look at, say, a sequence of realizations of N Bernoulli, this is a sequence of zero ones, but you are looking just of the sum of the axes, which just counts the number of successes. And because the successes can happen in different ways during the sequences, there will be many such points x, but however, no matter how many you have, if their sum is equal to the sum of the x's, which is the count of the number of successes, is the same r, then they belong to the same partition, okay? And of course, the partitions are those because when you look at what can happen when you send those axes, then possible realizations of these sums are either zero, if you are, say, very unlucky, or maybe one, or maybe two, and maximal that can happen is n. So possible realizations are 0, 1, and so on to n, okay? And if you look at, say, all those n tuples that give rise to the same value r equal to 0, 1, or n, then you have created this sets, and they create your partition. You know that, of course, nothing else can happen when you have observed those n id Bernoullis. Then one of those events, they sum equal to certain r equal to 0, 1, 2, and so on, or n, okay? And so correspondingly, this statistic t, in namely the sum of the axes, which has created this partition I'm speaking about, is sufficient. But this is my claim. We still don't know, but we want to show it. Okay, so this is why our first example, I want to convince you now that this statistic is sufficient for it. Okay, and because this is the first example, because of course nothing else is reasonable to do than to just go from the definition. So this is the third page in this file that you have already seen, probably because I discussed this example during the previous lecture, and I told you that this example I'm not discussing, but you can consult it if you want to compare your solutions. And here is this third page, which gives you this claim. So we are claiming now that this partition AR, that defined that way, if we create those partitions, they are sufficient partitions for my case here that I'm dealing with. And so we said we will look at the definition. Remember, what was the definition of sufficient partition? We have to look at the conditional probability of the sample vector to be equal to certain small x, given that we know that this x is in the set AR. That means the n-tuple of components of this x is such that when you sum them, you get small r. Okay. And so how do we do this? This is conditional probability. Conditional probability is the probability of the intersection divided by the condition probability for the condition. Okay. Now, what do we know here for this x belonging to AR? It just means that if you sum its component, it gives you small r. Okay. So here you have one particular small x, and you have this intersection. Of course, this probability here will be zero if for a particular small x, the sum of xi's is not equal to r, because then this intersection here is just empty. Okay. However, if it happens that the sum of the components of small xi is equal to r, okay, then the probability of this intersection is just the probability for x to be equal to small x. Because this is, say, the smaller event. This is one particular tuple which gives rise to some of its components equal to r, whereas here we may have much more. So if you're looking at what happens here, it's basically you have two events, and one is say such, and the other one is such, and you're looking for the probability for the intersection of the two. And in this case, of course, the probability for the intersection of the two is just the probability for the smaller event. Okay, so this is the smaller, this is the bigger event, the probability then is just equal to the probability for the smaller event. That means the probability for a particular sequence of zero ones that has altogether r ones. And of course, this probability is given here. This probability is given here, yeah? Because you're just plugging in the formula was this, okay? And you plug in here each of the axes, the n-tuple. Some of those axes are ones, others are zeros, but altogether you have r ones. So when you multiply and you get this sum here, and here you get then n minus xi, okay? You multiply this. And now you just notice that the sum of the axes is equal to small r, okay? So then here you have theta to r and 1 minus theta to n minus r, okay? And this is what happens with the event that is on the top, this intersection. Whereas in the bottom, what do we have? You have the probability for certain vector of zeros and ones, with each component being Bernoulli, to have the sum of its components equal to r. That means you are repeating n independent times Bernoulli, and you are counting the number of successes. And we know very well from our introductory statistic courses that this distribution that counts this number of successes is exactly the binomial distribution with parameters n and theta. But then this corresponding probability, which you have to put here at the bottom, so this is the binomial probability for distribution with parameters n and theta to have binomial distributed random variable with parameters n and theta to have the value small r. Okay, and of course this is n choose r, theta to r, 1 minus theta to n minus r. And what happens now is, as you can see, that top and bottom, everything that contains theta cancels. So as a result, you get 1 over n choose r, and this is independent of the theta. No matter what theta was, this conditional distribution of x being equal to this n tuple, given that you know the information that the sum of the x components is equal to r, does not depend on theta. It depends on r, of course, but it does not depend on theta. And you know, the other case when this probability of the intersection was zero, of course, you get then zero as a result, and it is also independent of theta. So no matter whether you are in this branch or in this branch, the conditional probability does not depend on theta, okay? And so that means exactly that you have created sufficient partition. This sufficient partition was created by the statistic T equal to the sum of the axes. Therefore, this statistic T equal to the sum of the axes in the case of the Bernoulli with parameter theta is sufficient for the parameter theta. I hope this is clear. If there is a question, please ask. If not, then we continue our discussion? So we have checked now sufficiency, and because this seems to be very reasonable as a requirement, we will formulate, say, as a principle of inference. We should, when we do, say, inference about the parameter theta, we should stick to this principle, namely that if t is sufficient for the parameter theta, then if certain x tuple n tuple x and y are such that the value of the statistic calculated on this tuple is the same, then inference about the theta should be the same no matter whether the x n tuple or the y n tuple is observed. And I already gave you one example how you can show that you have, say, sufficient statistic. However, the unpleasant thing is that sometimes this calculation of these conditional distributions may be problematic. Of course, in this textbook example that I gave you, it was actually easy, but in general, it may be problematic. And you would like to have some sort of criterion which would allow you by just looking at the joint density of your observations to say whether you can figure out what could be a sufficient statistic for your case, for the parameter that you're estimating. So you don't have to calculate these conditional probabilities I was speaking about, but just look at the joint distribution and try to give answer directly from it. And indeed, such answer is possible due to the so-called Neyman-Fisher factorization criterion. So what is this Neyman-Fisher criterion? It tells you now, if you have an ID observation, say, axis, and you have calculate, say, statistic, it's sufficient for theta, if and only if, when you look at the joint distribution of the axis, which we already denoted in our first lecture also as Lx theta, okay? Please pay attention that theta is the parameter. Then this joint density, which in the case of independent is just the product of the separate densities, can be factorized. This is why it's called factorization criterion. And how it's factorized, you can see here. So there is a multiplication of two functions. One is g, which contains the theta explicitly, but contains the value of the zampa only via the corresponding realization of the statistic. Not the separate axis, but just the transformed value through the statistic enter here in the argument of g, first argument of g. And then you have another possible multiplier if you need, but this physical multiplier, it may have the whole sample, but it does not depend on the parameter, okay? And this g and h functions are non-negative. So with other words, before we go to the derivation, we try to factorize the joint distribution into product of two non-negative functions, of which one factor may depend on the parameter theta, but depends on the sample only through the value of the statistic, whereas the other factor does not depend on the parameter. That's exactly what I was speaking about loudly before, okay? So this is actually very important, and because it is important criterion, I also want to give you justification of it. in order to speed up things, I have written them already, so I'll go through this slide. So Neyman Fisher factorization, and and remember that we had it is an if and only if statement. That means if a statistic is sufficient, then we have this factorization, and if we manage to factorize, then the statistic that we can get into this factorization is sufficient. Okay, so we have to show two things. First, one direction, and then also the other direction. First, let's assume that we have factorization. So we have the joint distribution, and it is factorized in the way that is quoted in the statement. Okay. And now we need to check that this T is sufficient for T. Okay. And please pay attention. When I say proof here, I really will not give the whole proof. I will only consider the discrete case, in which say x is discrete, then the t x is also with discrete realizations. When you look at the probabilities, you have to sum. Whereas the case of continuous is also true, but we just don't prove it here because the ideas behind it are similar. It's just replacing the summation that I will speak about in a moment with integration. Okay, so we have this factorization assumed to hold, and we want to now check according to the definition that we have sufficiency of our statistic T. For this, we remember that we want to calculate the conditional probability for your random vector n tuple to be equal to certain small x n tuple, given that the statistic is equal to certain small t. Okay. And we want to see that this does not involve theta. Then we know that this statistic is sufficient according to what we have already discussed. Okay. So again, we do the same thing that we did with the Bernoulli. So this is conditional probability. Conditional probability is the probability of the intersection divided by the probability for the condition. And now this probability in top again is zero if it happens that the value of the statistic calculated at this small x value is actually different from this small t. Then this is impossibility to have it both ways. So this is zero, which of course does not depend on theta. But if t of x is indeed equal to small t, then again we have the situation that we discussed in the Bernoulli case. So this is a small event, this is bigger event. The probability to an intersection is the probability for the smaller event. So we just have on top the probability for capital X to be equal to certain small x. And on bottom, we have the probability for t to be equal to small t. There is a question. I want to see what is the question before we continue. Could you please underline the part you explain? All right. So I was speaking about the intersection divided by this. So it's either zero or this, okay? Okay, so now we said that this is of course independent of theta, and this has to be calculated further. So now I focus on calculating this bit, okay? And I want to convince you that it also does not depend on theta. So what do we have here? On top, of course, we have just this probability for my nth tuple of observation to be equal to certain small x nth tuple of observations. Okay. What do we have on the bottom? We have now the probability for the whole, for the statistic to be equal to this small t. Okay. Now, we have assumed this probability is nothing else than the L function, and we have to now apply that no matter which n tuple x wave, for example, we take, which is such that the value of the statistic is equal to this small t, it is such that it contributes to the value of the statistic to be equal to small t. What I'm saying is that there may be many n tuples of observations, x wave, different from each other, which give rise to the same value of the statistic t. So if I want to calculate the probability for the statistic itself to be equal to this small t, I have to sum the probabilities for the individual axes, which are such that give rise to this small t. Okay, then I will get the probability for a realization of the n tuple to be equal to small t. Okay, as I said, there may be several axes, several n tuples of observations which give rise to the same t. If I want to calculate the probability for the statistic to have the value small t, I have to sum the individual probabilities of all these axes. But for all these axes, I have a sum that I have this factorization. Okay? So for each particular x, I can always replace the corresponding probability by g of t theta times h of x wave. And then what can happen is now, as you can see, that this is the same g of t theta that we have here also on top. So we can cancel it. Okay? There are different x waves. This g t theta is the same. I can, if you want to even put it in front of the summation, and in any case, I can then cancel it with this g theta that is on top. So I will end up just with h of x, and here I have sum of h's of x wave, which are such that the t of x wave is equal to small t. But of course, this whole expression that we have here definitely does not involve theta. So as you can see, we assume that we have factorization, and then when we calculate the conditional probability of x given small x given t equal to small t, we have realized that this conditional probability does not depend on theta, but that was exactly what we claimed under statement that this statistic t is sufficient. Now, there is a question here, Edwin. I think it's because this is the proof in one direction, so we can assume that the numerator can be factorized into g. Okay, somebody ask why, and so this is the answer. I already mentioned it. Okay, so the reason that we can continue from here to here is that for each those individual axes for which t of small x is equal to t, we can apply the factorization. We assume that this is true, and then we want to show sufficiency. This is again just one direction. Now we go over to the other direction, and in the other direction, we'll have under sufficiency to be able to claim that we can produce factorization. Okay, so indeed now let us assume that we have sufficient. Okay, and then if it is sufficient, do we know that the probability for x to be equal to x, the probability for the sample, of course we can add to it, say, always the intersection with the probability that t is equal to t applied on this small x, because this is just a transformation. If you know the small x value, then this is just plugging in the formula. It's automatically satisfied given that you know what is the small x value. So this probability is the same as the probability for this intersection. However, the probability of an intersection can always be written as the conditional probability of x equal to small x given t equal to t multiplied by the probability for t to be equal to small t. Okay. And now, what do we have here? We know that is t sufficient. That means that this conditional probability here does not depend on theta. That's the definition of the sufficiency. So we can write for this bit here just that it depends on x, but not on theta. Okay. And and then this conditional probability may depend on theta and on t. So this bit, I can replace it with g of t theta. But what's important is that this other bit, the first multiplier, does not depend on theta because there's some sufficiency. Okay. So if we denote that this bit as hx, and it is not depend on theta, then we have exactly produced this factorization that we were speaking about. This probability of the whole sample, which we also denoted as L, is factorized into those two terms, one not involving theta and another that involves the theta, but the sample is involved just via the value of the statistic. All right? Okay. So now let us go back to lecture 3 again. So we have shown, we have proved this Neyman-Fisher factorization criterion, okay? And the next thing is actually speaking about minimal sufficient statistics. But before doing this, I want to give you some examples. Actually, I should have continued with the slides that I had before, because I want to now give you several examples about the application of this Neyman-Fisher criterion so that you get a better feeling about what is going on. So several examples of using the factorization criterion to show sufficiency. And I will start with this Bernoulli example that I started with at the beginning, okay? Where I showed the sufficiency using the definition. However, now I want to use the factorization criterion instead and see that actually things can be really shorthanded that way. So remember that what was our claim for the Bernoulli, if we had NID observations and construct this statistic T, which is the sum of the X's, which virtually counts the number of successes in the N independent Bernoulli trials, then it is sufficient. And this really follows directly from the factorization criterion. I don't have to look at this conditional distribution. Really, if you look at the factorization criterion, we can directly apply it. What is Lx theta here? It is just the joint distribution of your sample of N Bernoulli. And that means for each of the xi's, you can write theta to xi 1 minus theta to 1 minus xi. Then you plug in x1, x2, xn in these multipliers, and you calculate the whole product. So as a result, what you will get, of course, you will have here the theta to sum of the x's, and 1 minus theta is to power n minus the sum of the x's. I draw your attention to this n because very often students do stupid mistakes when they do this. They write 1 here. It's not 1 because you have 1 minus x1, then 1 minus x2, and so on, 1 minus xn, and you sum all of them. As a result, you have n ones to sum, and you end up with n minus the sum of the x's. Okay? But in any case, when you look at now what you have here, you have now this expression, which I can just call g of t theta for t being equal to the sum of the x's. Because you see that now this sample enters into the description of L only via the value of its sum. So if sum of the x's is t, then you just have t, not the particular x1, x2, xn on the right-hand side, okay? So then you can say that you can choose g of t theta to be this function, theta to t1 minus theta to n minus t. And you don't need a function h here. If you want to, you can just set it equal to the constant 1, which of course also does not depend on theta. So here is your factorization. Take h to be a constant 1 and g to be this. Of course, this factorization is not unique. You can say take g to be 1 half of this product and then h to be the constant 2. Okay, doesn't matter. What is important is that you factorize the whole product. Okay, so here is another example. Normal with mu and sigma square. Now the parameter theta is with mu and sigma square. Okay. And so in order to show what happens here, and to find out which are the sufficient statistic. Now this statistic will be actually with 2 components. Not surprisingly, because you have 2 unknown parameters. In order to show this sufficiency that will pop up, I am using this equality, which is sometimes I call fundamental equality. The composition of sum of xi minus mu square into this bit. This is algebraic inequality. So x bar here is the arithmetic mean. So sum of the x is divided by n. You can easily check this equality yourself by just opening the brackets and then canceling whatever you cancel, having in mind that x bar is equal to sum of the x's, that means n times x bar is equal to the sum of the x's, of course. So using this simple relation, you can show this. And then let us look at the L function. We will apply the factorization criterion. So L function is the joint distribution of x1, x2, xn. So because they are assumed to be normal, you have always this factor 1 over square root of 2 pi sigma. And you plug in n times, so it will become to power n. And then in the exponent, when you multiply the independent densities, you actually sum the arguments. And so you have minus 1 over 2 times sigma square, and you have sum of xi minus mu square, which but can be replaced by what you have here according to this fundamental equality. Okay, so this is what you can write about your L function. Okay, and now you can see how this L function involves the data. You can see that it involves the data only via the value of x bar and via the value of sum of xi minus x bar squared. Okay, the individual axes do not enter here except in the form of their average and the of their some of the square deviations from the x bar. Okay, so now consider this to be two-dimensional statistic, vector statistic with components t1 and t2. Then, of course, you have factorized already because your Lx theta depends, is just this function, which is a function of t1 and t2 only. And again, you don't need the h function. Your h function can be just the constant one. Okay. So we have one particular sufficient statistic that we have singled out for the vector theta with component and sequence square, namely x bar and the sum of xi minus x bar square. Please pay attention, though, that these sufficient statistics, they are not uniquely defined. I can do any one-to-one transformation, and I still have a sufficient statistic. So if I can recover, say, certain T wave from T, and vice versa, if I have the one-to-one transformation, then, of course, if I know the value of T wave, I know the value of T. And because remember that it goes about the conditioning, so it will be the effect will be the same. And so, for example, instead of taking x bar here, the arithmetic average, I can just say take the sum of the x's as the first component, because the sum of the x's is n times x bar. So if I know x bar and know the sample size, I can recover the sum of the x's. Vice versa, if I know the sum of the x's, divide them by m, gives me x bar. And similarly, you can see here that if you open the brackets and you do some combination of the terms using the fact again that n times x bar is sum of the x's, you can express this t2 equal to this just by knowing the sum of the squares of the x's. And vice versa, if you know this and the x bar, you can recover the sum of the squares of the x's. Okay? So you can claim that this is also sufficient statistics. The next example is about the so-called irregular case. When the support of the density depends on the parameter of interest. So this is a case when you have this x1, x2, xn independent, uniformly distributed in the zero theta interval, and theta is unknown. So the support has involves the unknown parameter theta. And now the claim is that if you now look at the maximal of the observations, you have this maximal of the observations as the sufficient statistic for the parameter theta. Please pay attention also about my notation here. We have the example which is denoted as x1, x2, xn. However, we can also introduce this notation, x1 in bracket. x to in bracket and so on, x and in bracket. So these brackets that I put here are not for beautification. They have specific meaning. So these are the so-called order statistics. So if you had your original observations, which were denoted as x1, x2, xn, okay, you can now take the sample and see in this sample which is the smallest one of the n. And you call it then x1 in bracket. And this is your minimal observation, of course. Then similarly, you look which is the second smallest, and you denote it as x2 in brackets, and so on. And you continue that way, and in the end, the maximal of those n observations will be denoted as xn in bracket. And this is called the nth order statistic. So the minimal observation is the first order statistic, then this is the second order statistic, and the last one is the nth order statistic, which for example of size n contains is equal to the maximal of the observations. Okay, now if you have this uniformly distributed in zero theta, first of all, it is in intuition tells us that probably the most information about the position of this theta should be given not by average or by some other value, but really by the maximal of the observations. Is this clear? Tell me. It's just because you are estimating the right-hand side of this interval. So you know that whatever x you have observed, your theta is bigger than it. And it is bigger even than the biggest of the observations, because all of them are meant to be in the zero theta interval. And if you know where is the maximal of the observations, of course, the other ones don't really tell you anything about where theta is. Oh, the information is really hidden in the maximal, because you know that you are even on the right-hand side of this maximal. So it's not surprising to claim that indeed the maximal of the observations, this nth order statistic that I'm speaking about, okay, this one, somehow should be most informative about the theta, but of course we still have not proved mathematically that it's the sufficient statistic for the parameter theta. So let us do this according to the pure, say, definitions that we have introduced. So first of all, I claim that this density that is sketched also here on this graph, its density formula can be also written this way. I have already used this argument in my lecture last time, using the indicators. So indicators are very helpful, and you see now why. So this density I just say can be written that way, where this is the indicator of the interval x infinity calculated at the point theta. So basically, this means that if theta belongs to this interval x infinity, that means when theta is bigger than x, this indicator is 1, okay? And then the density is 1 over theta, which you can see here. X is less than theta, theta is bigger than x, that means you are here. If you are here, the density is 1 over theta. However, if you jump over, so if you take any x that is, say, here somewhere, it's just impossibility for your distribution. And this indicator is zero there, okay? And that's what you want to say, that the density is zero if your x is bigger than theta, okay? So in this one line, I have actually accumulated those two lines that saying that the density is 1 over theta, when x is between 0 and theta, and it is 0 if x is bigger than theta. However, what is the benefit of using this one line notation? The benefit is that when you look now at the L function, which is what we need to consider when we try to do factorization, then it can be very easily written using the indicator function. So what do we have here? We have to plug in x1, x2, xn in this formula and to do the product. And then, of course, you will get a 1 over theta to the power n in front as a constant. And then you have to do the product of those indicators of the intervals x1 theta, x2 theta, and so on, xn theta, each time calculated at theta. Now, knowing that these are indicators, that means they are either 0 or 1, and you multiply them, you know that the result of the multiplication is again an indicator. Okay? When you multiply zeros and ones, you end up either with 0 or with 1. And now, when do we end up with 1? You will end up with 1 when all those indicators are 1. In all other cases, you end up with 0. So all those indicators to be 1 means that this theta had to be bigger than each and every of those x's. And then logically, this just means that theta should be bigger than even the biggest of the x's. Okay? That means theta has to be bigger than the maximal of the observations if you want these indicators to be all equal to 1. And this is equivalent to know whether, theta belongs to the interval maximal of the x's to infinity. So this product of the indicators logically can be replaced by this indicator of the interval maximal of the x's infinity to theta, calculated at theta. And now I have produced my factorization. Here I can again say that this is my function, g of my statistic and of theta. It depends on theta, of course, but it depends on the sample only via the value of the maximal of the observations. The rest does not matter. Okay? So this is a function that depends on my statistic, namely maximal of the observations and theta. And again, I don't need in the factorization an h function, I can set it equal to 1. Okay? So the next example is about the multivariate normal, which we have studied in our first lecture. And here the situation is similar to the univariate. We need again fundamental equality for transformation. So what is the claim first? We have now x1, x2, xn. They are n iid, but they are p-dimensional multivariate normal data vectors. And what this means, we have studied the density, the p-dimensional normal vector, normal distribution, sorry, has as parameters the vector of the expected values of each component, which is denoted, say, by mu. It has p components, mu1, mu2, mu p, which are the expected values each of every of the components. And then the sigma, which is the p times p variance covariance matrix of this normal. Knowing this, we have written down explicitly the density of the p variate normal. Each of our n axes are such p-dimensional multivariate normal. And so they are vector observations, each with p components, okay, n of them, okay? And now something which is analog to what I called fundamental equality in the Previous in the one-dimensional case is true here. Now it goes about matrices. Now remember that you had first here sum of xi minus mu square, and here sum of those and n times this square. Now what is the difference? Here now you have, instead of xi minus mu square, because you are dealing with p-dimensional matrix, you replace this by xi minus mu, which is p times one vector, multiplied by this transpose, which is one times p vector. So it gives you each time p times p matrix, okay? And you sum all those n matrices, and the result is then equal to this. So sir, you have again x bar now is a vector of averages component wise. You have now, instead of the sum of xi minus x bar square, which you had before, it's analog now in the multivariate case is again this, where this is transposition. And again, instead of the n times x bar minus mu square, you have n times x bar minus mu multiplied by x bar minus mu transpose. So this is p times p matrix equal to the sum of those two p times p matrix. And also there is another important relation from linear algebra that we will be using, namely there's a properties of traces. Namely, if you have, say, the trace of a square matrix is just the sum of its diagonal elements. So the trace of A times multiplied by XX transpose. So this is P times P matrix and actually symmetric matrix, and X transpose is also symmetric. So this is this trace of this matrix, and the trace is one number. Remember, just the sum of the diagonal elements. It can be also calculated in this way. So you have X transpose times A times X. X is P times one, so this becomes one times P. This is P times P matrix, and then P times one. So as a result, you get this just one scalar, and this scalar is equal to this other scalar, namely the trace, okay? So this is again an easy relationship, which you must have proved when you were in first year linear algebra course. And if you have forgotten it, I just recall it for you to be used, because indeed we will need to use it. So the question here is, for this p-dimensional multivariate normal, for which the parameter is the p-dimensional expected value vector, and this p times p symmetric variance covariance matrix, positive definite, what is the sufficient statistic? Okay, and we will answer this question again by looking at the factorization. So we write down the L function. The L function is a product. If you look at the formula that I have given you at the first lecture, you have this 2 pi to minus pi over 2. It has to be multiplied n times. So that's why you have minus mp over 2. Then you have this determinant of the sigma to power minus 1/2, or 1 over the square root of the determinant, but now you have to multiply n times, so it becomes the sigma determinant to power minus n over 2. And again, in the exponent, you have to sum. And when you sum there, instead of writing each time xi minus mu transpose sigma minus 1 times sigma, you use the trace operation and you write it that way, and you use then the fact that the trace is a linear operator, summation is also a linear operator, so you can then apply here this trace of the sum. and when you apply the trace of the sum, for the sum, you apply this fundamental equality. And so at the end, what you end up with, again, with that the density can be represented in this form. And when you look at what it is, it really involves the data, not via all the individual n p-tuples of observations, but it is just through this value and through the x-bar, which is the component-wise average of your p-vector. So then this means that if you take, say, t1 to be x-bar vector and t2 to be this p times p symmetric matrix, then you will have sufficient statistic for the unknown parameters mu and the variance-covariance matrix sigma. Before I continue, I need to look at the chat again because there was a question. Is X transpose here the transpose or the inverse? It is the transpose, yeah. So I have used this notation from the first lecture as well. And I mentioned that when I use the transpose, sometimes I may use the t number, but sometimes it's just denoted as dash. Okay. If I have inverse, then I will say -1. All right. So this is what these are all examples about the sufficient statistics. And now let us go back to the lecture and continue with the notion of this minimal sufficient statistic. So we have mentioned what are already sufficient partitions, but we have already noticed that we may have, say, not just one sufficient statistic, and in particular, say, if we have, say, t, which is sufficient statistic, we have found this, but it can be recovered by using another statistic. So if t of x is certain function of u of x, where u is certain statistic and g is known function. That means each value of the t can be reproduced by values of u and the known function, okay? Then the claim is that u must also be sufficient, because here is why, if you use the factorization criterion, if t is known to be sufficient, then Lx theta has this factorization. However, for t itself, you can write g1 of ux, and then this composition of function g of g1 of ux, theta can be, of course, written as another function g bar, which involves ux and theta, okay? And it still has here this part which does not involve theta, but only the sample. So then you have achieved factorization of the same type for your Lx theta, but now involving u instead of t, which means that U must be also sufficient. Okay, so that means if you now use such functions which statistic which can reproduce a sufficient statistic, then they are sufficient themselves. However, you can easily see that these functions produce a coarser partition, finer partition of the sample space. And if you want to look for the greatest data reduction without losing information about the parameter, then you will be looking for the coarsest partition, because this means that this contains the smallest number of sets that can be used to safely reproduce conditional distribution of the data given the realization of the statistic without losing information about the parameter. So to summarize, we will be looking for the coarsest possible partition. All those U's that I have listed here, they produce a finer partition, and so they are they are sufficient, but they are not sufficiently condensing the information without losing information. That's why you would prefer to have the coarsest partition that is still sufficient, because this means, if you have it, that you have produced the greatest data reduction without loss of information about the parameter theta. And such statistic T that produces the coarsest partition that is still sufficient is also called minimal sufficient statistic. So we will be very much interested exactly in this minimal sufficient statistic. Before we go into details to discuss how this minimal sufficient statistic can be produced and found in particular cases, I have summarized here the properties of sufficient statistics until now, which we discussed. So I will just read out without any further comments, because I already commented thoroughly on each of them. So is T sufficient? So is any one-to-one function that generates of T also sufficient? If T is minimal sufficient, it is necessarily a function of all other possible sufficient statistics. And if T is sufficient, then the conditional distribution of X given T does not depend on theta. The observed value of the statistic small t is a summary of the sample that contains all the information about theta in the data under the given family of models. It gives the sample space, it divides the sample space into disjoint subset, each containing all possible realizations x which give rise to the same value t. And before I continue again, there are some questions in the chat. If it's quick, could you please give a concrete example of U1 and U2 such that U1 is not equal to not equal U2, but G1 is equal to G2. Now, I don't think your question is very, very accurate. You probably didn't mean this, because I can always play around with the G's here, but without even touching the U's. But you are interested in the different U and U1 and U2. Slide 197, I mean. Which is this slide 197? I don't see it here. What is G in slide This is what you're asking. Generally speaking, U introduces a finer, or at least no coarser partition than T, since it might happen that we have different U1, U2, but yet the values, G1, there's a finer partition of any sufficient is. You're looking for example. Yeah, for example, think about say X bar, and then some estimator of variance, and you say different variance estimators, but the same X bar. Yeah, so if you look at say that the variance and the mean, then this will be say many of them, so there will be finer partitions, but the X bar itself being the same, they will be in the same partition. So if you just say like projection on one of the components, and one of the components being the same, but the other components being different. And you Or for example, take other example. Okay, say in the zero theta interval. Okay, we know already that say x, the maximal of the x is sufficient. Okay, but you can consider this vector statistic. Yeah. So again, I'm speaking about projection. Say the minimal of the x is and the maximal of the axis. So this vector statistic, okay, it will produce finer partition, okay? But if you just take the maximal of the observations, it will produce a coarser partition. So this minimal and maximal of the observations, this vector statistic, of course, can give you the maximal of the axis as a particular case, okay, but it produces a finer partition, okay, and in this case, say the vector statistic of minimal and maximal will be sufficient also because the maximal itself is sufficient and it can be reproduced from the minimal and the maximal, okay, but the minimal and the maximal as a vector will not be minimal sufficient, but the maximal of the observations, as will turn out in the example that I will show you, turns out to be minimal sufficient. Is this clear? All right. And so here are sufficiency examples, which we'll again discuss quickly. Say for the Bernoulli, for the univariate normal, for the uniform distribution and multivariate normal with unknown mu and sigma. Here, before we go over there, I just have summarized in a nice form here in these slides this fundamental equality that I have discussed and mentioned in my discussion until now, including a proof, although the proof is very simple, I already indicated it, and also this other fundamental equality that I also used in the example for the p-dimensional case. Okay, so now we are now that we have seen that the minimal sufficient statistic is a function of every other sufficient statistic, we will discuss now Lehmann and Scheffé's method for constructing minimal sufficient partition and respectively minimal sufficient statistic. For this, here is a theorem, and it has a relatively lengthy proof. This relatively lengthy proof, again, will be something that I don't require. If somebody of you is very, say, interested in these theoretical developments and proofs, you can also study it. And if you have questions, you are welcome to ask me. However, I will not require this proof. So I will just summarize the statement of the theorem and illustrate how it is applied in particular cases, because the derivation is a little bit more challenging here. So to summarize, Lehmann-Scheffé method, as opposed to the factorization criterion of Neyman-Pearson, gives you a way to find minimal sufficient statistic. What you do is the following. You consider partition script A of the example X by defining for any X this AX equal to AX, X is certain n-tuple, okay? And you now do the partition in the following way. That for each fixed x, you take all those y's which are such that when you calculate L, which was the joint distribution, calculate it for the same value of theta for the y tuple and the x tuple, and taking the ratio, so the ratio of L y theta over L x theta at the same value of theta does not depend on theta. So it's the same theta, however, because x and y are different depending on how they are, say, what are their realizations, this may happen to depend on theta. So then the corresponding y and x are not in the same partition. So they're in the same partition when this ratio does not depend on theta. Okay? And if it's not depend on theta, that means it's a function of the type h of y and x, because only depends on the n-tuples but not of theta. The above defined sets form a partition of x, and this partition is minimal sufficient. So if you are looking, say, for minimal sufficient statistic, you will have to see when you look at the ratio of L y theta and L x theta for two independent n-tuples of observations, which is the transformation that makes it of the data, which makes this to not depend on theta. Okay, so this is what you will be looking for. And so now, let us give examples. Let us give examples illustrating how this really can be done in practical situations. So some of these examples are a little bit artificial in a sense, because for simplicity of the explanation, I have taken, say, one-dimensional parameters at the beginning. But if you have one-dimensional parameter, then the minimal sufficient statistic, of course, cannot be of dimension less than one. So if you have found a sufficient statistic which is of dimension 1, then you already know that it is minimal sufficient just from dimension considerations. But nevertheless, we will not use this argument. We will just use the Lehmann-Scheffey argument to explain why, say, certain statistic terms out to be minimal sufficient. And let's start again with the Bernoulli. So we have, according to the criterion that I just formulated as a theorem, the Lehmann-Scheffey, we need to do what? We take, say, two independent entropies, say, x1, x2, xn, and y1, y2, xn, both from Bernoulli with the same parameter theta, and then we take the ratio of Ly theta over Lx theta. Or Lx theta over Ly theta doesn't matter, because what we are looking for is whether the ratio does not depend on theta, and if the ratio does not depend on theta, its inverse also does not depend on theta. So the way I have written it here means now for Ly theta, write this, for Lx theta, write this, and then we can cancel 1 minus theta to power n, and you will end up with theta over 1 minus theta to power sum of the y minus sum of the x. And now I question it. When this does not depend on theta, which transformation with statistic makes it such that this does not depend on theta? And it's obvious which is this. Statistic is just the sum, because if it happens, say, that the sum of the x is equal to the sum of the y's, then on top you will have the power 0, and then no matter what your theta, you will have something to 0 power, and it's always 1 and does not involve the theta value. Okay? And so that means that t equal to the sum of the x's is minimal sufficient. Okay? So now let's take, say, normal with mu and sigma square. And again, this two parameter vector mu sigma square is of interest. We want to construct minimal sufficient statistic. And again, we follow the Lehmann-Scheffey method. We construct the L of y theta, Lx theta, which if you plug in the data, cancel the constants, which are the same in top and bottom here. So you remain just with the exponents, and in the exponent, where you have, say, sum of xi minus mu square or sum of yi minus mu square, you do expansion of a minus b square, and then you can easily rewrite this that way, and the rest cancels. So n times mu square cancels. So this is what you get. And then you can see now that if you want this not to depend on theta, how can it happen? You have exponent, you have theta with mu and sigma square. Obviously, in order for it not depend on mu, this difference here should be 0. That means sum of the x's should be equal to the sum of the y's. But still, because sigma square is a part of the theta parameter, it is still, even if you don't have this bit, it still, it depends on the component of the theta, because you have the 1 over 2 times sigma square. So you have to require also that this sum of the squares of the y's is also equal to the sum of the squares of the x's. So sum of the x's equal to sum of the yi, and sum of xi squares equal to sum of the yi square will guarantee that this ratio here will not depend on the theta, no matter what happens. So that means the t with those two components, sum of the xi and sum of the xi square, is minimal sufficient statistic. And you can see here that this is also one-to-one transformation with the sufficient statistic that we have found in the earlier case. This is one. You can see that you can transfer into one-to-one transformation from here into the new one, and from here as well. These are all one-to-one transformations. So each of them can be considered as a minimal sufficient statistic. When you look at the uniform and zero theta, again, as I said, we already have seen that the maximal load observations is sufficient. And because it is one-dimensional parameter, you cannot have sufficient statistical dimension even less than one. So you can automatically claim that the maximal observations is indeed minimal sufficient. However, again, for pedagogical purposes, we just follow the Lehmann-Scheffé method. And we then look at the ratio of Lx theta, Ly theta for two independent n tuples of observations, each coming from uniform in zero theta. Okay. And we have already discussed what those were in the previous example. We had 1 over theta to power n, which we have on top and bottom. That's why it is canceled. So we don't write it. Okay. So this 1 over theta to n. It is on top, but you also have it on bottom. So it is canceled. So you really just have the ratio of those two indicators. All right. Maybe I'll delete this. Things so that you can see more clearly. And so what you're looking now is whether this ratio is independent on theta, and in which case it will not always be. But what I claim here now, you have to now look at the maximal of the x's and the maximal of the y's and put it on the real axis and see whether this, after you put it and start moving your theta, it will depend on theta or not. Because it's meant not to depend on theta. And if, say, the maximal of the x's is equal to the maximal of the y's, you have just the ratio of the same indicators, and obviously this will not depend on theta. So that is fine. But we want to show that in all other cases, this ratio will indeed depend on the theta, will be a function of theta. So that means for different thetas, you have different values. So the only way it does not depend on theta would be when x in bracket n is equal to the y in bracket n. That means the maximal observations for the two samples coincide, which means then that the maximal observations is the minimal sufficient statistic. So for this, I have shown you here how you can do this. Showing that if the maximal of the x's and the maximal of the y's does not coincide, what is the consequence? The consequence is that indeed, depending on the position of theta, you have really different values of the ratio when it is defined. And first of all, let me say, choose this case when, say, the maximal of the x's turns out to be bigger than the maximal of the y's. And then, first of all, before the maximal of the y's, if you start moving your theta, then this ratio is not defined because it turns out to be 0/0, and 0/0 is not defined. However, if you're looking now, say, in this region, okay, then your indicator on bottom already becomes 1, okay, because your theta is bigger than the maximal of the Weiss. But top is still zero because your theta is not bigger than the maximal of the axis. So you have 0/1, which is then zero. However, as soon as you move here on the right hand side of the maximal of the axis with your theta, okay, you consider as a function of theta because you want to show whether it depends or does not depend on theta. So then both indicators here will be one, so you have a ratio of one. So that means if you look as a function of theta over the region where it is defined, and it is defined from here onwards, then it is first zero, but then it is one. So it is not a constant with respect to theta, it depends on theta. Similarly, if you look at the other case, because there are only this case, and the case when they coincide, nothing else can happen. So in this case, similarly, the ratio is not defined here, but then when you are here, now the top becomes one and the zero, and the bottom becomes zero. So you have 1/0, which symbolically can be interpreted as in a limit, as infinity. But then later, when you are on the right-hand side of y, then both indicators are again ones, and so the ratio is equal to one. So again, in the region where it is defined, and you accept, say, that infinity is also proper definition, it's only not defined here because 0/0, then you have here first infinity and then a constant. So again, it depends on the position of the theta parameter. It is not constant with respect to theta. So if you want to have it constant with respect to theta, you have to require x maximal to be equal to y maximal, which means exactly that the maximal of the observations is minimal sufficient statistic. There is one question again. Why is it 1/0? I don't understand. You just, because you can just 1/0. Okay, but just think about that you are here, your theta, okay? And you're speaking about distribution, which is in the zero theta interval, then x is a reasonable realization, okay? So this indicator on top is one. But y is not possible, okay? You cannot have y on the right-hand side of theta because you know that your example is in the zero theta interval. So density there is zero, so this indicator is zero. That's why I have 1/0. Is this clear? Yeah, I hope so. One more example is here, which just shows you that not necessarily the dimension of minimal sufficient statistic is equal to the dimension of the parameter. Until now, this was always the case. For the normal with two parameters, we had two-dimensional sufficient statistic. For the uniform in zero theta, we had one-dimensional sufficient minimal sufficient statistic, and so on. However, if you take this example, which is the so-called Cauchy distribution, with centered at around theta, Cauchy distribution is is symmetric around theta because you square here, but it falls down in the tails less heavily than for the normal. It because here you have just polynomial fall of the tails. The pi here is just a Norman constant because this is being a density has to integrate to one. So this is your Cauchy distribution. And theta is one-dimensional parameter that is unknown. However, if you take now L of y theta over L x theta for two n tuples of observations from this distribution, you cancel the pi's, of course, but then you have this product on top and this product on bottom. And then you can see that the x's may not necessarily coincide with xi with yi, but after you order them from the smallest to the largest, then they have to coincide because each multiplier on top has to cancel with certain multiplier on bottom if you don't, if you want this ratio not to depend on theta. That means x, the smallest of the x's should be equal to the smallest of the y's, second smallest of the x's should be second smallest of the y's, and maximal of the x's should be coinciding with the maximal of the y's if you want this ratio not to depend on the parameter theta, which means in this case, your minimal sufficient statistic will be the whole vector of order statistics with all those components, mixed minimal observation, second minimal, and so on, and maximal. And of course, having in mind that this sufficient statistic, minimal sufficient statistics are meant to reduce the sample information, you see that in this case, no reduction at all has been happening because you have original vector of n observations and you still end up with n dimensional minimal statistics. So this is sometime unpleasant, say, example that is kind of a little bit just showing that not always in life you can be always happy. I have to stop because it is 8 o'clock. Now, I have to discuss also again some examples of the so-called exponential families, which directly allow you to find minimal sufficient statistics just by looking at the shape of the individual densities. But because this is a relatively lengthy story and I don't want to overdo it, I will stop here and we will continue on Tuesday from here onwards. So for now, I'm wishing you a pleasant evening. And I will later also make announcement about what you can expect for next week.